Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop.
Man, so I am back from day one at Woodworking in America, and let me tell you something. And I am beat. It's kind of a smaller university. In fact, actually, this is a map of Berea College, and I know it doesn't really matter to you because the next time that they're going to be having this conference, and I highly recommend you attend one of these. It probably won't be in Berea. It's going to be elsewhere, but, I mean, that's a lot of walking around to do. And it's only from, like, these two areas to here, but let me tell you something. When you're carrying around a lot of equipment, it can wear you out. So what I ended up doing is I took some footage from each one of the classes that I attended, and I just kind of want to give you an idea of what it would be like to attend these, because I didn't really want to film the whole entire thing, mainly because I was afraid I get shaky hand cam, you know, and nobody wants to see that. But just kind of give you an idea of what you're about to see. The first clip I'm going to play for you comes from my Modern Tools and Tolerances and Myths class. And this was taught by John Economaki, owner of Bridge City Tools, Robin Lee, owner of Lee Valley, Thomas Lee Nielsen, of course, Lee Nielsen Toolworks, and Conrad Sawyer, who makes some of the most amazing infill planes, and that's Sawyer and Stein hand planes. So let's take a quick look at the footage that I got from that.
Things that are best to start off with as your first tool, would this be the appropriate place to discuss bevel up versus bevel down?
That's in the bevel up, bevel down.
Well, I spent 7 years of my life as a professional furniture maker. I don't know how you can function without a block plane. I mean, it has so many applications. I think you have to have a shoulder plane. There's so many ways that can help clean up your glare. And then after that, it's what are you making? And that's going to determine what you need to buy next. But those would be my two must-haves, you know, as a user.
I agree with the block because I made so many mistakes in that. That's the save plane. You know, I always have to, well, I can't put stuff back on, so I always have to remove a little from something. And a block is it. For me, I use a very small block, so similar to Tom's one.
Small planes are awesome because a big plane to do a small job is really awkward.
Yeah.
So I suggest a smoothing plane that you consider a smoothing plane as well on the top for you. Especially if you do a lot of prep work on machinery. Is that going to be useful for your as well?
Alright, so what did you think? That was a great class. To have those four makers up there talking about modern manufacturing and everything was really, really excellent. And the time that they took to answer questions from the audience was amazing. And I've got a whole bunch of notes. So we're going to talk about that single topic later on because I want to kind of share those notes with you. I got some really great information out of it. Now, the next class that I ended up attending was called Master the Spoke Shave and Draw Knife, and that was by Michael Dunbar. Again, amazing teacher. You know what? He did such a fantastic job. I would love to take a class with him at the Windsor Institute. So who knows? Maybe that's something further on down the road. Now, again, I got a little bit of footage, just a couple of clips here and there, a couple of highlight things, but I think you might enjoy it. So let's take a look at that next.
Which some of us get because we go to, you know, roll mills and things like that and get our own little scoop round edge. How to straighten it out, how to joint an edge. Well, the draw knife, if you snap a chop line, and you can go along with the draw knife and hit off all the high spots that come down close to the chop line. And then you can either run it over your joint or you can joint it with the hand. But let's see what happens. Short of my brain, I can actually break them off. They actually, you know, level off the pieces the other way. So that's the drum. Let's now go to the spoke shape. Now, spoke shapes are a little more interesting in that they come in a variety of shapes. You can see this one has a flat sole. That's the one we've been looking at. Mm-hmm. precursor for doing curves. And then a small one for more of the details. And one of the great things about this, if you've got a really tight curve coming down like this, yeah, when you come down in here, you're going to get a place where you stop. And there too. And typically, if you've got something like that, you have to go across it with like a chisel or something across the ring. If you've got a long curve like this, then you can overlap in this area. Scrapers are great. Use them all the time. But if you've got a bump, the scraper doesn't take care of the bump. It goes over the bump and then just keeps the tension. Who else would like to try it? All right, come on up. Let's go.
So not so bad after all. I mean, that's a great class. And again, learned a ton of information from it. And Michael Dunbar, amazing teacher. Now, the next one I did, I kind of switched things around a little bit. It was kind of the freedom of having the press pass. If you came here with your, you know, regular registration, you really wouldn't have this opportunity, although you could probably ask. And if the class was open, there was quite a few classes that were completely sold out. But it very easy probably to get yourself into one that you maybe want to take because, you know, as it got closer to the conference, you became interested in something else. Now, the one I ended up originally signing up for was the hands-on clinic on rehabbing old tools, but I ended up taking one called Understanding Sharpening Media, which was taught by Ron Hock, who you should be familiar with, Hock Hand Plane Blades, or Hock Blades, I should say, and Joel Moskowitz, who you're probably not familiar with, but he's the owner of Gramercy Tools. And they got up there and they talked about like the different types of steel. They got up there and talked about the different types of sharpening medias, all sorts of stuff. I definitely got a ton of information on this one. I'm going to have to go back through my notes because, to be honest with you, I was just really getting so enthralled by what they were saying that I was kind of forgetting to take notes. But I'll make sure that I come up with something. So let's take a quick look at the clip there and well, let me know what you think.
But this is in Arkansas, you go out to the quarry. Norton actually owns most of the Arkansas, the vitrolite mines in Arkansas, like seven or eight companies that own it. By far, Norton is the largest. You go out, not during the winter, because stone will fracture, cold stone fractures more easily than stuff that's very brittle. Not after a hurricane, which is why I owe you Arkansas stones, I'm sorry. The mines are flooded. They're drying out the quarries. The lake will have completely. I get no stuff. And you take gunpowder, because it's a slower explosive. You blow up some cracks in the rock. You take it back to your warehouse. Now, when you take your chunks of stone, you make a big block and you fill all the voids with plaster of Paris. So it's a solid block. You stick it in a machine like this, where these are steel bands. 1 inch across. And did you see this? That's abrasive. Okay. Now, this is taken in the 50s or the 40s. This photograph is taken in the 40s. This machine operated until the early 90s. This technology, but it switched to diamonds. And what you do is these go back and forth. The abrasive slowly wears through the stones. If you have an Arkansas stone from pre-90s, the reason its finish is so smooth is because it's been sliced like this, and the process actually makes very smooth crystals.
What's the block underneath it?
Underneath.
Like bread?
Yes. Sliced like a giant bread slicer. This takes days, I think. Yeah. They replaced all of this with diamond stones. The problem with diamond stones is you actually get a coarser initial cut. However, over time, not too much time, the Arkansas wear in absolutely beautifully to incredibly fine texture. Now, I recently brought this in because of it's an interesting piece of history. Around the world, when they figured out after the post-Civil War period, Norton has figured out a vitrified artificial stone, where you basically can take a bracer, put it in a binder, you stick it in an oven, you get something hard, it's a good artificial stone. That technology eventually ended up in Japan, where they took water stones, and they did the same sort of thing with different binders. in Europe, they've had water stones for centuries, but it will still be mined. Your German razor homes, all sorts of crazy stuff. But now most people are using artificial abrasives, which most come from about 1900 when we started inventing the artificial silicon carbons, the artificial aluminum oxides. And you're ready now to start talking about what technical properties of stone makes sense. Because what is a stone from a chemical and engineering standpoint? And now we're back to you, Bob.
So that wasn't so bad. I mean, that was definitely a great class, and again, got a ton of information out of it. Now, the last class that I had for the day, again, this is another one of those I kind of switched things around, and originally I was going to take vintage tools, their advantages and disadvantages, and value, and this was taught by Roy Underhill and Clarence Blanchard, but I ended up taking a class that was called Understanding Western Saws, and it was taught by Mike Wensloff. Again, Joel Moskowitz, the owner of Gramercy Tools, and Mike Wensloff, you should be familiar with it, Wensloff and Sons, hand saws, and just amazing hand saws. And, of course, Christopher Schwartz kind of acted as like the MC. And this was a really, really spectacular class because they got into all those questions about, you know, selecting the right saw. What does it mean by the rake? What does it mean by the pitch? What do you mean by phlegm? All these things that, you know, I'm going to pick their brains. I'm hoping that I will definitely have an interview, and I'll let you know for sure if I do with them, because I really want to have an opportunity, especially Mike Wensloff, to talk to him about all these things that we're covering in here. So again, let's take a quick look at that one so you can get an idea of what it would be like if you were here.
The bottom line that I like to tell people about rake is that, you know, the trade-off that you're doing is that, you know, as the tooth is more upright to the work, then it's going to be more aggressive, but it's going to be, you know, harder to start and harder to push. And as you relax it, as the tooth leans back, the saw cuts slower, but it will definitely be easier to start and you do less work. And so that's the principle that you want to get to. So if you are diagnosing, you're like, what you don't like about a saw or what you do like about a saw, that is one factor back and forth that you need to consider. And there are lots of others that we're going to get to, including the next one, which is fleam. And most people, you know, it's kind of a word that actually is not talked about very much, but the fleam is the bevel on the face of each tooth. And the bevel is ground or filed traditionally on a crosscut tooth, though you can find some bevels on some rib teeth. You know, I mean, with saws, there's everything. You can find an example for anything. So, but in general,
right here.
Yeah.
That's a rip tooth with fleam.
Yeah.
So when you file a rip saw by hand, especially if you're like us, you can go like so and keep your tooth totally parallel. But the reality is, when you look at a hand filed saw, there's always a kind of a little bit of fleam that gets filed into the teeth. Because it gives you a little bit more action on the sides. It's not at all unusual, and it's actually really nice. I think, right? It's a good thing. Zero fleam, I think. I don't know if I like it.
You heard it here first. as far as fleam, the trade-off, I think, and you guys can sound off on this one, but the trade-off with fleam is that, you know, as you get more angle, you know, as you angle that file more, to file a bevel on the front of that tooth, is that the saw cuts more sweetly, more smoothly, with more fleam. But you do have a more delicate edge, marginally more delicate edge, and so you might be sharpened even more. And so the converse is, as you have less fleam, it won't be as a sweet saw, as smooth a saw in the cut, but the edge will be more durable. Would you say that's unfair?
Yeah, I think it's, unless you go to extreme pain teeth, the fragility of that edge is not a big issue. A pain tooth is basically 45-degree bevel front and back, 45 degrees of fleam. But unless you drop way back like that, typically you'll never file more than 30 degrees of fleam. I don't think it's an issue. Not in modern steels. Mm-hmm. The modern steels, the rock wall hardness is a little harder than what it used to be, and it's a lot more durable.
So you would sound like you're making an argument for lots of fleam.
No, because it cuts slower. Mm-hmm. I don't care about the smoothness. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I care about the smoothness.
I know you care.
But when a very caring person asks for the fact is that I'm even if it's a finished length cut, there's going to be some sort of processing afterwards. If it's a table leg, I'm going to chuck it in the vise. I'm going to take a few swipes into the center with a plane. It's going to get cleaned up in some way, shape, or form. It's going to be hit on a shooting board or something. And even what I would consider a finished cut.
I'm trying to minimize that. I want to know that when I cut something, you know, it stays cut. I don't have to basically shoot a 64th of an inch off it. The less I have to shoot, the better. If it's something, especially if it's something that's not really seen, and it's a clean cut, it's a clean cut. If you're cutting a shoulder, which I think is one of the most common things, I want to be able to say that when I look at my shoulder, you know, I'm done. I don't have to hit it with a shoulder plane unless I screwed up. So I do want a smooth cut, and you know, I
Joel likes swing.
Against what you just said about you like aggressive songs, though?
This is a dance.
Dance of contradiction.
It really is. I like a really aggressive saw that cuts really smooth.
It's called a table saw.
The thing is that I can play with that a little bit by increasing the pitch. So I can make something more aggressive that gives me a smoother cut, but I have more teeth. But that only works if I also file the gullets problem. But yeah, it's a whole trade. I can't look at anything in isolation. I mean, that's why there's a bunch of criteria. And yes, every once in a while, you get this thing where this is contradictory. So where do you draw the line?
All right, so what do you think? It was pretty good, huh? You should have seen that class was definitely, that was very, very electric. There was some great discussion going back and forth between Joel and Mike and Chris, and let me tell you something, that class ran a little over, and I wasn't sorry one bit. It was a great class. So anyways, though, that is pretty much going to wrap it up for today. Got a whole full day tomorrow, so I will let you know what's going on with that. Again, I'll have more clips, and I think that's pretty much going to do it. So until tomorrow, straight grains and sharp blades.